So the irony of hitting live while you're solo parenting is that there's fights going on right now. You just can't see them. Oh, the joys. So I wanted to talk quick about ways that you can thrive while you're solo parenting. And I realize this applies to only some of you. And some of you have been doing this for a long, long time and you're pros at it. So if you have anything to add, please do. One of my really good girlfriends just replied to my story about not sleeping well while my husband is gone. Go to your room now, and you better not wake up Atticus. How her oh, about how I've not been sleeping well with Lucas gone on his business trip, and she's like, yeah, I haven't slept well in 7.5 years. And I'm like, oh my gosh, it's so hard. Like, y'all give yourselves so much patience because, and just be so patient with yourselves because solo parenting is not for the faint of heart. Like, these are things, I'm on day one of a 5-day trip. The longest I've done with the four kids is 10 days. And that was a little cray cray, especially because it was during the winter. And I had, like, I think a 1-year-old. He was really, really young, maybe less than that. So, things that can help you thrive. And I'm talking about thriving in a, like, not feeling like you're losing your mind, not feeling like you are losing your mind. So, having sanity, but also feeling like things are more or less under control and they're going well. Granted, this will not happen all the time, but I think there's things that we can do and things that I mentally prepared myself for during this time. So, the first one is to set your routines. Routines are so important. We as human beings need routines. We thrive on them and they are important to us. You want to know what's happening in your day. And that's not necessarily a set schedule thing. For instance, I didn't wake up until 9 o'clock this morning. My kids, praise the Lord, my daughter is 10. They're all pretty responsible, but they had bagels that we had gotten yesterday, so they made themselves bagels for breakfast. And so I slept because I was up until 4 a.m. because I couldn't sleep. And so my routine when I woke up, because I was kind of sniffly this morning, air quality hasn't been great here with forest fires. I put some snifflies. Yes, this is the kids one. I put some snifflies into the diffuser, put some on myself because it smells so dang good. It's like a spa. Like, it smells like a spa and it's so good for sniffles, sniffly noses. It's great. So I put this into the diffuser because part of my routine is putting the diffuser on when we wake up, when I wake up. It sets the tone for the day. And I am not joking because oils for emotions are legit. We have noticed a marked difference in our house when I put the diffuser on, when I put oils in the diffuser. That's a class for another day. But setting the tone, I'm the gatekeeper of the house. Realistically, moms control so much of the temperament of the house. And that is, it's huge. Like, it's huge to understand. And that's why when a spouse goes away, you want to keep having those routines so that you can keep things moving along. Secondly, so we have routines. Secondly, know your schedule. Whether that's in a wonderful, soon to be redone Faith and Focus planner, or you have a different planner that you love, knowing your calendar, I even have to set. So I love my paper planner, but so the paper planner helps me stay organized, helps me know what I'm doing, having my phone camera or my phone calendar keeps me on task. So I will set reminders. So it's like, hey, leave for piano. And I make sure that I adjust the alarm to when I actually need to leave instead of the appointment time so that I'm getting us ready to leave out the door. I give us some margin because realistically, a kid's always going to have to poop before you go somewhere. Like, we just know that that's going to happen. And so having that alarm helps me know my schedule, and I always have my phone with me. I can just pop it open and say, okay, what's happening the rest of the day? Or somebody texts, hey, can we do a play date? Knowing my schedule when I am with my phone helps me so much. After that, the routine, the schedule, and if this is a short-term thing, I think it's really important not to add a ton of extra things to no thank you. Go to your bed. Your dad's on here, so he's going to hear what you're not doing. Not adding a ton of things to your schedule gives you, as I said, margin, because margin is that lovely thing that when things happen, when things pop up, when you're like, okay, so kid randomly ran into a picnic table, that's going to give you the time to allow for things to happen, for life to happen. If it's a long term, like a deployment, you have to do life. And I know that if you are a seasoned military person, or if this is a long-term gig, like a spouse works like second shift or something like that, or third shift, you know this, but it has to be said. Leave yourself margin and give yourself space for life to happen so that life can happen and it doesn't throw everything off. I think that's one of the biggest things that I've learned in the last few years is you always have to give space for the unexpected, whether that's allowing God to show up and like popping somebody in your life that you just need to talk with, you need to meet with, you just, you know, have to send a message, whether it's space for things like that. Or like I said, kid poops and you're like, we're running late, let's go. You have to be ready. And then long term, one of the things that I learned when my husband was deployed was to make sure that I not only had a set schedule, but I was also leaving time for community. So we were having friends, we were having play dates, and I was just missing my friend this afternoon tonight because I was like, oh my gosh, I haven't had human interaction with an adult in a while. And when my husband was deployed, I used to have friends that we could just like pop over, and like we lived down the row from one of them during one deployment, and then during the other one my sister was living with us and we had other friends in the area, and I was missing them so much tonight because I was like, it was so nice just to be able to have that little touch. Because you have to have community. You have to be living together with people and humans and having people that are just going to help you, whether it's being your sanity, whether it's something that you can't do by yourself, whether something comes up where you're like, hey, I need you to watch the kids. Having those people are amazing. So those are kind of my three things for helping you thrive with solo parenting. Routines, systems, give margin, and know your schedule. I didn't talk about systems, actually. Kind of with routines. Have systems. That was one thing. So this business trip, actually, Lucas found out he was leaving on Wednesday morning. And I was like, okay, well, let's hope my systems work. Because when you have systems that work, then it's less brain work, less potentially work for you. And it gives you space for Like, he does the dishes and does the laundry. So he'll be home to do the laundry. Thanks, babe. But dishes every night, I don't do those typically. And I don't read with the kids typically either. So praise God that my husband is able to do that because it gives me time to do other things. That is a routine that we do. The systems that I have created allow me to pick up the chores that he leaves when he leaves. So I am able to do the dishes at night and not feel stressed about it, or at least feel less stressed. And systems that we have created. So I was talking about the new Faith and Focus planner that's getting designed. I was on Voxer with my designer, and while I was running to the park and while I was with the kids this afternoon, so we were just chatting back and forth, and that was something that was off my plate. Like, systematically, it's not necessarily a huge system, but it takes time. I delegate it to her. And then our system is I put things in Voxer that I need her to work on, and she knows that they're in there. And so that saves me time with I don't design my stuff. I really am not skilled in that area. And so she makes things beautiful for me. The other system that I have is checking in with my accountability coaching clients. So, as I know it's Monday, as I'm taking care of some stuff, I'm saying, hey, what are your plans for the week? What are your goals? What is, I'm getting notes. Lucas, Abraham has the window open by his bed. The systems and everything else that we do. So that's the weekly check-in. I know I need to do it every week. It saves me from thinking. I'm not gonna lie. I know it's Monday. I know I'm hitting up three people and saying, okay, what are your plans for the week? What are you working on? How's this going? From there. There are more systems, more in depth, but I'm gonna leave it at that for tonight. I have to go take care of the window that needs to get closed, and I'm gonna go to bed myself. So, have a great night, great day. I hope this was helpful for you guys. If this is the season of life that you are in, obviously, I have four littles, 10, and the youngest is 3.5. So, my life season is a little bit different than other people's, but there are still things that are applicable that you can take if you have newborns, if you have, teenagers. Goodness. All right. If you have questions, pop them in the comments. I will be happy to help. Lucas will probably also be happy to answer questions if you have any questions for him on how he did his stuff. Maybe that's something we can do another day, is how he prepared for the trip and just our workflow and working together. Because I feel like by now we kind of have it down. Maybe. All right. I'll talk to you guys later. Bye.